Islam.
Islam.
We'll make some peanut butter sandwiches. You're not from the peanut butter
you know, because we don't deal with drugs and all that type of stuff. So this went on for about a month, him in the madhouse, and us having this dialogue. So eventually his court date came up, went to court. Based on his conviction in what the prophet brought, he went and did the same thing again, knowing that they can probably do the same thing to him again. Went up there, said his thing, and the judge, when he told his story about what happened, they put him out. The judge said, "Oh, really?" Made the prosecutor apologize to him, threw out all of his charges that he had, and sent him home. Right? That's without nationality card. That's without a free national name. That's just a brother reading the information, digesting the information, trusting the information, and choosing to exercise it. Right? Truth about nationality and birthrights. Like it's real. It works. Right? The thing that we have to be mindful of is them using torts, tactics, to make it seem like we're wrong, right? This is mainly for people who don't have terminal feathers that might not have had any experience with dealing with the people out there when you start exercising nationality and birthrights, right? Second example, there was a brother that used to come around by the name of Kushray L. So he had a situation with his neighbor hearing something, calling police, then they say he's abusing his child, took his children away, and all that type of stuff, right? So, you know, he was battling the court thing for a while, just going in there, you know, the same thing. Spit something at them, oh, we don't want to hear that, you know, this is Canada, you can't say that, you know, Canada's not part of North America, and all this type of stuff, right? They're just going through the whole motion, right? So one day, his court date came up, goes to court. This is after they had him locked up for about, I think 13 days, 12 days, 13 days, something like that. Goes to court for his court date, sitting there, waiting. Court closes at 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock comes, he's sitting there, waiting. You know, one of the court clerks comes into the court, asks him, "What are you doing here? You know, you want to go home. What's the problem? What do you mean, what am I doing here? Like, you guys brought me here for court, and nothing's happening. Well, maybe you should just leave." Right? And he was wearing his like orange jumpsuit and all that stuff. So he called me from the court. He's like, "No, you wouldn't believe what just happened. You know, they just kicked me out the court, and I'm walking home right now in my orange jumpsuit." Right? And that was because he was threatening the judge that he's gonna sue the judge and all that type of stuff. And the judge kind of took it personal, so wanted to pay him back by having him walk home in the orange suit so the world can see, you know, this brother walking home, you know, in the orange suit, right? But, you know, without knowing the story, people are just gonna look at it as, look at that, you know, that nigger just walking down the street, you know, or he probably just got out of the jail, not knowing that, yeah, he might have did some time, but, you know, no nationality card, no paperwork, no anything but information that he got from class that he said, you know what, yeah, this makes sense, you know, get a law dictionary, get out of British dictionary, research, check out everything, and you realize that it's something that's real, right? It's not organization, group, cult, sect, it's yours that if you don't exercise it, then you don't have it and everything is for naught, right? The last example I want to talk about is with myself at the job that I work at. Right? I work for the school board as a hall monitor. So I go around like truancy officer, tell youth go to class and stuff like that. So at the interview, go into the interview and you know, they do the application form, you know, check off black, all that, white, and all that stuff, right? So I checked off other, right? And I just left the thing. He's like, oh, you know, why did you check other? He's like, well, you know, I'm brown. You guys don't have brown on the thing. Right, it's a European, right? And the lady that was doing it also was a European. So they're looking at each other. Okay. So really because, yeah, like, that's really why you didn't check it out? Yeah, because I'm not black, I'm brown. Like, clearly I'm brown. I never heard that before. When can you start the job?
Yeah.
And that was it. That was my interview to work for a quote-unquote school board that, you know, is apparently, you know, you need all these credentials and stuff to work in the school board, right? So I was just brought up just to let you know that it's something real. We're in Canaanland and we are exercising birthrights. You know, some of the Moors, you know, still today, we know we've been out there maybe about 4 years dealing with this, more still today with no nationality card. Standing up on nationality and birthrights without a card, without paperwork, without anything other than what they have in their mind. You know? And once we start from that perspective, start from having it here first, and then get into the activity, because I know, you know, especially over in Canaanland, a lot of the little stuff that you can get from nationality and birthrights is what comes up, right? So we talk about nationality and birthrights, then somebody was, oh, okay, do you guys pay taxes? Oh, well, do you guys have passports or right to travel or anything like that? Right, from the people who don't know, right? And we've probably had, you know, the same people coming around for the past 3 years. We had many people jump ship. We had many people who became agents to the corporate states were on slandering us to try to make it look like, you know, we don't know what we're talking about. We're trying to overthrow our Canadian government. Right? We've had people. We've had undercover literally come into our class and sit down and ask questions and everything and have nothing and just have to leave. Right? We've had, if you know about when we were in the news a few years ago, right, with the sister that got her child taken, right? That sister jumped ship, right, became an agent. The husband, he got deported. But when he got deported, because he was part of the case, he got all the disclosure. And in the disclosure, you could just hear her. That's definitely her talking in the disclosure. That's definitely the sister who chose to, whether she took a check, whether they said, we'll give you your child back. You know, let us know everything that you can about the Moors, whatever it is, right? She didn't understand the truth about her nationality and birthrights. That's why she jumped ship. She thought that, well, all I have to do is, you know, nothing. And let Grand Sheep do everything. And we'll get out of this. When really and truly, we're teaching everybody in Canaanland that comes to our classes that everybody has to be a Grand Sheep. Like, that's the prerequisite. That you're coming in knowing that you're eventually going to have to go take your own temple somewhere else where you live. Because that's how much work we need to get done. Right? It's like, you know, like I hear Brother Nature and Taj say, like, we just do this because, you know, you have to do something. But really, everybody's supposed to be doing this. Every individual is supposed to be a Grand Sheep with their own temple, with their own body of Moors, right? To get the word out there. Because the word's getting out there, but it's getting out there splintered because of YouTube and, you know, people want to have debates, people want to be Vince McMahon of consciousness. Right? And they want to sell the idea of, well, if you come into this, you know, you're going to have to A, B, C, D, E, F, G, when it doesn't work like that. This is your stuff. You know, Lomu Jwali himself said, this is your Moorish movement. I'm your prophet. I brought you everything it takes to save a nation. Take it and save yourself. But we don't want to do that. So I don't want to drag on too much longer, you know, because I'm here for the lecture too, right? So I think we'll probably do the music thing after.
Whatever you want to do, right? Brother, you can make something, whatever you want.
All right, so since people have been waiting, you know, so what I would like to do right now is if we can do like Marcus Garvey says, right, and canonize our saints. And I would like us to please welcome our two distinguished brothers to the podium, Grand Sheikh Taj Tarik Bey and Grand Sheikh Nature El Bey. Islam.
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 Islam. Islam. Arise and give praise to Allah, give honor to his only divine prophet of Kudjo Adwo. Give honor to all active Moorish Americans, Moorish hordes here in North America, true American citizens, loyal, faithful, sympathizers. Give honor and honor to Islam.
Islam.
Honest
to you.
Islam, we are definitely appreciative of everyone coming out today and traveling from their respective territories. It's a special honor to our Canaanland Moors who have sojourned with us from afar in North America. Islam.
Islam. Islam.
We just want to camel back off of that thought for a second, because they refer to Canaan or Canada. We refer to it as Canada. They refer to it as Canada. But they refer to it as North America. So what I want to raise in our consciousness is, where is North America? And that actually goes into the topic of this particular lecture. Prophet Nova Jawali said, come all ye Asiatics in North America, hear the truth about your nationality and your birthright. So who was he speaking to when he said North America, the Asiatics in North America? And this has been a part of our European psychology that we accepted through the educational curriculum here in the United States of America, Inc. So we're going to address these issues today. Me and Brother Taj Tarik have done a series of lectures in the past dealing with these same issues. They might have been under different titles, but they all umbrella the same thought. And it's important that we all galvanize these thoughts in our mind and become active and do something about the subject matter. Because as the prophet wrote in What Shall We Call Him, when he spoke to the various journalists from across the land and so-called leaders that claimed to write about the history of our people, he questioned them and says, well, if you accept the teachings that they brought these so-called black people here from another land, he said, did not the land that they were brought here from have a name?
Small.
Did not the people that you brought here, did they not have a national name when were brought to these shores, if that's the story you got? And for a journalist or any scholar, PhD here, it shouldn't be a rocket science to figure that information out. Because if you came from another land, whatever land you came from, that is the name, that the national name that your people are known by. So how can you bring someone here and call them black when there's no black land that you give honor to? So that brings us to why we are in this lecture today. Islam?
Islam.
So we're dealing with North America. But where is North America? They said that this continent, or split continent they refer to, is made up of North America. They say Central America. They say the adjoining islands. And then they say South America. Well, let's look at that. How can they all be America? Can you have multiple continents within a continent? So we have to look at these issues. Is it a continent? Now I want to bring you to teachings of the Prophet Noble Drew Ali. On page 3 of the Holy Quran, at the bottom, it says the industrious acts of the Muslims of Northwest and Southwest Africa. These are the Moabites, the Hamathites, the Canaanites, who were driven out of the land of Canaan by Joshua and received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle in that portion of Egypt. Listen what he says. He said, settle in that portion of Egypt. What he's telling us is that Egypt was a lot broader in scope, in landmass, than what they're saying Egypt consists of now. And highlight that in your mind, and we'll revisit that later on. So they settled in that portion of Egypt. He said, in later years, they formed themselves kingdoms, which means that prior to them establishing that terminology of kingdom, there were no kingdoms at this time. But they were considered to be in a portion of Egypt. That's another clue. He said, these kingdoms are called this day Morocco, Algiers, Tunis, Tripoli, etc. So these are clues. The Prophet said he couldn't tell us everything. If he told us everything, we'll go back to sleep. So the literature is put here for us to do further investigation. And he's challenging us to study. Study ourselves, study our land, study the creed, study the nationalism that's associated with the different body politics of the different lands. We have a lot of studying to do to actually proclaim any nationality. Because it's a fact, before we even say what our nationality is or what we choose it to be, because the people do have that right to choose the name of what their nationality should be. But before we even get to that point, we have to realize and recognize that it's a fact that we are not black people.
Small.
That's the first recognition that we have to come to before we can even call ourselves anything other than that. Because if you truly in your mind think that you are black, then in your mind there's no need to change it. Why change something if there's nothing wrong with it? So this is something that you first have to convince yourself of. Islam?
Islam.
Todd, do you have anything you want to add on to that?
Islam. Islam. Rise and give honor to Allah, the most holy and divine prophet, Muhammad Ali, and to all the wonderful works he brought to us in the North Gate. Giving honor to the principles that he set forth. And in harmony with Grand Sheikh Nature, we as Grand Chiefs will have a responsibility to keep the nation, the people, up to date with what's going on. And at the heart of the movement, as you all know, is the enforcement of the covenant contract constitution for the United States of North America. And the mission is identified by the Prophet in the divine warning to the nations where he says, help me to bring my people, help me in my mission. He tells you what the mission is, to bring my people back into the constitutional fold of government. Now, so as a snippet, so that we have a concept of the geographical territories of the Moroccan Empire, we look at chapter 47. But also as a reminder, and Sister Delilah presented this to me about a week and a half ago, which we knew about, but we needed the evidence. This is the incorporation papers of the United States Corporation, distinguished from the land. And one of the things that the people have to understand that the United States is not the land. It's a corporation, a private religious corporation belonging to Europeans, having nothing to do with the land. Now, I want to make sure that you copy this if you don't have it. And also, we want to remind all Moorish Americans of the politics that govern you, that you've been miscalling racism. Race is the species, but we've been trained to call race as an attitude, the circumstance, when the circumstance is really the Treaty of Verona, spoken of on the floor of the Congress. And this is what they're operating on. And the Inquisition operations still continue here. And this is also one of the problems that we have, that why we even have to do this now, today, and as we have to do it for years. If you all take a look at the wall right there, and you see the Prophet's newspaper, Moorish Guide. Well, I want to take the moment to just read to you and remind you all what the Prophet have to say about what you see on the wall. And then you got to put in context Calvin Coolidge and J. Edgar Hoover with COINTELPRO operations. These are statements from the Prophet. The greatest weapon in the hand of our group today in America is our press. The truth will never be told about a disadvantaged minority by the general press of any country.
Islam.
Whether that minority be racial, political, or religious, unless we express ourselves through papers of our own, the truth about us will not be told. Our papers are our only hope of shoveling ourselves out from under the avalanche of lies that are annually let loose upon us. A strong free press is the best possible safeguard of the liberties in general and promotion and defense of the interest of a strong free people. That's Noble Drawley himself. Then, of course, you had infiltration taking place under COINTELPRO operations. So let's look at some other work that the Prophet did to save, to try to preserve this for you. We organized as the Moorish Holy Temple of Science in the year 1925 and were legally incorporated as a civic organization. Under the laws of the state of Illinois, on November the 29th, 1926. And the name Moorish Holy Temple of Science was changed to the Moorish Science Temple of America, May 1928, in accordance with the legal requirements of the Secretary of State of Illinois, Prophet Noble Drawley. So the COINTELPRO members that work for J. Edgar Hoover with the infiltration of the movement have been going around the country discouraging any production of literature, which is a charge Noble Drawley put on all of us. And keep this in mind. When you look at shakuns, rabbis, imams, ministers, masons, all of them are PhDs. It is required for anyone having those titles to produce literature. and not just because the Prophet said so. The Prophet said so because it's a principle that's universal around the planet. And they're carrying these titles, and they made sure not only that they shut down the Prophet's paper, that the Moors were discouraged of producing literature, which is why we're here after 100 years trying to dispense this information to people who should have known this information 90 years ago, including knowing the issue about nationality and birthright without it being us going through, leaping through hoops and trying to convince them about their bloodline, their pedigree, their inheritance. And the other deal that must be understood is that this U.S. corporation that our people don't know is a mere entity, corporation, distinguished from the land, and it is our responsibility to report to you, most of you who are sheikhs, sheikhesses, and those of you who know the issue of birthright are aware of these things. However, for the nation at large and brothers and sisters who come into the movement who have no knowledge or little knowledge of what's going on here, it is our duty and responsibility to protect the Prophet and the movement and keep you aware of what's going on. So I'm going to read just a few paragraphs from the floor of the Congress for the United States of America to let you know what's going on, because you need to be made aware why you must nationalize, why it's in your interest, not just because it's a historical fact, because it is your bloodline. Unfortunately, much misinformation about the movement as presented as if it's a belief system, a religious system competing with other Islamic religious systems, when it's actually the restoration of your inheritance, your lost estate, your titles of nobility, i.e., and your hereditaments, corporal and incorporeal. And of course, if it's not presented correctly, the people look at it as if you're trying to convert them to some kind of belief system, when actually their inheritance and their birthright is being delivered to them and it's been distorted. So let's talk about what all your congressmen know, what all your ministers know, being Masons, what all your senators know, including all these people running for the praetor position that you call the president. So let's talk about what they all know. United States of North America, addressing the House of Representatives and Speaker Representative James Traficant of Ohio. Now keep in mind, right after he spoke on the floor, Gingrich spoke, same Gingrich that's running for praetor now. Now, understanding that most of these guys are Skull and Bones, Knights of Malta, Knights Templars, 100 degrees of the Klan, etc. And most of them have stock in the 14th Amendment for persons called Negro as Christian property, passed exactly like real estate. But they think it's prejudice. So let's talk about what they're talking about governing your life, right? What everybody knows, including all these Negro leaders that get a 501c3 agreement with the Jesuits to keep the fraud going on about marching our people around, wasting their time when they don't know they're on their own land. Mr. Speaker, this is James Traficant, representative. We are here now in Chapter 11. Members of Congress are official trustees presiding over the greatest reorganization of any bankrupt entity in world history, the U.S. government. We are setting forth, hopefully, a blueprint for our future. There are some who say it is a coroner's report that will lead to our demise. It is an established fact that the United States federal government has been dissolved. By the Emergency Banking Act of March 9, 1933, 48 Statute 1 Public Law 89-719, declared by President Roosevelt being bankrupt and insolvent, H.J.R. 192, 73rd Congress, in session June 5, 1933, joint resolution to suspend the gold standard and abrogate the gold clause, dissolved the sovereign authority of the United States and the official capacities of all United States governmental offices, all officers and departments, and is further evidence that the United States federal government exists today in name only. The receivers of the United States bankruptcy are the international bankers, via the United Nations, the World Bank, and the International Monetary Fund, and all United States offices, officials, and departments are now operating in a de facto status, in name only, under emergency war powers, with the constitutional Republican form of government now dissolved. And the receivers of the bankruptcy have adopted a new form of government for the United States, and this new form of government is known as a democracy, being an established socialist communist order under a new governor for America. And this act was instituted and established by transferring and or placing the office of the Secretary of the Treasury to that of the governor of the International Monetary Fund. Public Law 94-564, page 8, section H.R. 13955, reads in part, the United States Treasury receives no compensation for representing the United States. And it goes on and tells you that the fiat is a fraud, that currency is not money, and that you've never been paid, etc., etc. Now, this common knowledge is supposed to be known to all Moorish Americans, because we're part and parcel of this said government. And the government has been overthrown right in front of your face. Meanwhile, our people are paying taxes to a foreign entity of European operatives for COINTEL operations that are faking as government, and the governors of the Moorish movement right on down have not reported it to the people. That's COINTELPRO operations. Mm-hmm. And most of them should be unseated at once. However, because the people don't respect government, they're going to let these thieves misrepresent the prophet in this movement and never challenge them. However, I don't play for them. Because my babies are not going to be somebody's slave. And I didn't come into this movement to play with them. And I didn't come into this movement to misrepresent this movement. I'm going to tell you what it is. I don't care if they don't like me. They're a fraud. They've been misrepresenting the prophet. They shut down his paper. They criticize any Moor who does anything positive to raise these people up. They're watching our people be packed into jails while they know an artificial, foreign, not sanctioned government that our people are paying to for their own enslavement. And they're getting kickbacks on them to keep the fraud going. Meanwhile, the civilized world, in accord with what Noble Drawley said, has set up a committee of 24 for dissolution of colonial governments, with the U.S. corporation being number one on the list. That report was supposed to be made to all Moorish Americans through all the regencies called temples, because they're also regencies. Because those persons were put in power to make law. And they've been telling the people that Drawley don't teach civics or law. And if you got a government and a nationality, that's civics and that's law. And if your mothers and fathers are the founders of civilization, the science of civilization is civics. And Drawley established the Moorish Holy Temple of Science as a civic organization, and the religious affidavit was adopted because people were coming from churches from all around the country, and they didn't know how to protect nationality and birthright issues or an estate. Therefore, Herb's Law was dealing with principles of association for them to preserve their rights still and their inheritance. And they were all supposed to teach these people estate law, whereas all of your hereditaments were to be embodied or put in trust within the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, unincorporated, in order to protect it and secure it, because all of your property, all registrations of vehicles, every marriage license, etc., every birth certificate were mortgaged by these same Europeans and put on the stock market. And that's why you're poor today. That's who counts. It's not us. You understand? Let us be dust. If it takes for us to be food for them, so be it. We're too slow anyway. We're either in park or neutral all the time. Now, the real deal of it is, what you must know, and as we presented to you earlier, that the U.S. corporation is a surety security and holding company. As an example, how many of you know who these three Europeans are? Clifton Barton, Helen Idell Barton, Lawrence Excoveria. Who are they? They're the private Nazi owners of the IRS, a private corporation having nothing to do with government. How come you don't know that? Now you're adults, so what chance do our babies have when we won't study? And the prophet told us to study. And then people who claim to be representing the prophet tell you don't study this stuff while you're getting screwed. Well, guess what occurs? All the taxes that you're paying doesn't go to no United States Treasury because it doesn't exist. That's why when you see the paper says the IRS and Treasury Department is the Treasury of the Popes under the Treaty of Verona. And not one penny goes to schools, not one penny goes to the streets or anything. It goes to European bankers. That's why you're broke. And you keep paying for your own enslavement. You all these set up the Moore Science Temple of America, it is itself a government. And it has been misrepresented. And he told you to maintain a grand treasury. He said, beggar people cannot achieve the highest spirituality in themselves. So all the fiat that you've been so-called paying, which represents your labor, been going to the popes of Rome via the Inquisition Revenue Services that they call the Internal Revenue Services, backed up by the representatives on the floor of the Congress themselves, to the popes of Rome. How come you don't know that? You don't even know who you're paying. And you're only doing transferring your labor because you're not allowed to have money. And when you go to these jobs, you haven't even been paid. Which, of course, he says again, admits in here, this is the Florida Congress. These people that's running around here telling you to vote for them. If anybody should be aware of constitutional principles and the preservation of enforcement of that constitution, it should be every Moorish American with a turban and fez on, even if it's no one else, because that's the heart of this movement, the enforcement of the constitution. And without your free national name, and you recognize in your national government a name and principle, you have no true wealth. So don't talk about no job, because all you're doing is sharecropping. And you need to know that. You don't need to get angry, you need to get wise, and you need to get busy. And you need to study yourselves, and you need to study this movement honestly, and recognize this is a redemption movement. And it's for active people, not passive people, as they talk about in the treaty. You understand it's dangerous. And the other issue is dangerous to your welfare. But the major issue why it's important for you to know this, because if you're not familiar with this information, don't feel upset because we're talking it. They're talking it every day in the Congress. You're the only ones that's outside the box. So don't think this is rare information. It's just that you're out to lunch. Say this.
Wait, I just want to add on, because as you breaking this down, I want to make sure it's clear that we all understand parliamentary procedure.
Yes.
Because as being a citizen of any government, we have a corresponding duty to understand its components and its mechanics on how it operates. As Brother Taj is speaking about the Congress of the United States of America, even though the United States of America has no congressional powers that they're speaking about, under a democracy form of government that they have disguised as legitimate government controlling the affairs of the land. I'm going to define and explain what Article 1 is in the United States of America Constitution, because it's important to understand the mechanics of what we're reading. And Article One, section one deals with the legislative branch of government. And it says, all legislative powers herein granted shall be vested in a Congress of the United States, which shall consist of a Senate and a House of Representatives. Now, there's more text within that, but I'm going to stop there just to explain how important this is. Because the legislative powers of the affairs of this government is vested, which means it's fixed in a Congress of the United States. That means it's fixed and unchangeable. That's something that the citizens agreed upon in a republic form of government, which is a people's government. That's when you're speaking about a republic form of government, in which it stands and which it shall be, which it shall remain. That means that it can't be changed. So now, as he's reading this treaty and these so-called policies that they have instituted, if that's the case, then what happens to the legislative powers that was fixed in the United States? This is something we have to question. Because if that's what they're going by, then what happens to the vested powers that was already agreed upon? There can't be another government that was formed. So what, the way I speak, I'm playing the advocate. What I'm saying is I'm raising a red flag in your mind, as this is something that you should think about and question. And like Brother Todd is saying, question your representative. And the final question goes towards the Congress. Because every term, they have the ballots that's based on these people being in office. And what happens is, if we acquiesce to what they're doing and don't be active in government, then they are re-elected into these positions to do the same thing that they've been doing all this time that we've been ignorant of. So if the power is really in our hands, we just have to understand it first, and then we choose our representatives based on qualification. And then our representatives are charged with handling these issues. Everybody understand that?
Islam.
So now my question comes to Brother Taj once again. Because they have spoke about the United States being a de facto government at this point,
so now this
what happens to the republic form of government?
They dissolved it as stated, and instituted the code word for COINTELPRO operatives, meaning that for Inquisition operatives who work for the Popes, which means your taxes and the legislation comes from the Popes through England and then to the US war machine to enforce it. In other words, they're working in a trinity now. The US corporation is a war machine and a drug pushing machine. It has nothing to do with the people. Meaning that the people here, you're only, for them, you're expendable. Are we clear? The finances that collected in the East Gate, meaning in the Vernal Equinox, according to the Circle 7, because they operate on these principles, they still operating on the science, is transferred to the Queen of England, and then it's split with the bankers and the Popes of Rome. None of it goes here, which means you're being drained. They're attacking you. Understand that they are de facto, which means they are imposters. They're a fraud. Do you understand? They're claiming offices that don't exist, meaning that they've taken over the government. They're claiming offices. The people think that they're legitimate. They're imposters, and we're being passive, and we're paying them to undermine the republic, which is tied absolutely to you. Keep this in mind. When President Obama went to Hikupta is the proper name for what you call Egypt. Egypt is a sociological name, and so it was given because that's what you're used to. But it's actually Hikupta. And he exposed to the world that the United States Constitution is derived from Muslim law. At the same time, Michelle, his wife, goes to the Alhambra, the last stronghold of the Moors before they were thrown over by the Popes of Rome. The people came around her like a queen. Of course she is. Of course the title is greater than that, but for the common people will say queen. The message is sent to you. Then he comes back to North America and he immediately signs the rights of indigenous people, reversing the policy of those skull and bones operatives called Bush family and Clinton and all of those who would not sign it. And you are the aboriginal indigenous people of the land. Read chapter 47. United Nations established in around 60, special committee of 24 for the dissolution of colonial governments. Paralleling that is the process by which the indigenous people are to declare their nationality, which is mentioned in Universal Declaration of Human Rights, that's in 48, Declaration of the Rights of a Child in 59, treaty law enforcement under the Clinton administration, and then now again with the rights of indigenous people signed by President Obama, which Article 5, Part 5, commands that these people have a right to their nationality. Principles of rights of the child, universal. Every child shall have his birth, have a right to a name and a nationality. And the instruction was given to all civic groups, all churches, all non-governmental agencies, at all costs to distribute this information to the masses of the people. How come you only come to the Moorish Science Temple to hear about your nationality? When it's, this charge has been put on all civic groups throughout the country. That indicates to you how big the sellout is.
Let me explain something based on that sellout. So we can identify the sellout. As Brother Taj mentioned, the Moorish Guides was in circulation 1927, 1928, 1929, etc. It went on for a few other years, officially under the administration of the Prophet. 1935 is when it actually, the organic Moorish Science Temple was actually shut down. Now, within the Moorish Guide excerpt, we have an article from Oscar the Priest.
Can I interject before?
Yes, sir.
And one of the principles I said before, and I'll remind you. Now, Sheikah's Nika and Grand Sheikh Nature made sure that the Prophet's paper is reestablished so that communication can be made with the nation, support the paper. But that's one of the principles that the Prophet set up. Keep this in mind and really think on this. The Prophet himself said, this is our most powerful weapon. That does not take anything from the Quran, chapter 7, nor the questionnaire. The Prophet said that our press is the most powerful weapon. Why is it that across these countries you got people calling themselves grand governors that condemn this? What does that tell you if you're intelligent? I suggest that in your spare time that you go look up FBI investigations of the Moorish Science Temple and go look up COINTELPRO operations, and you'll know why them guys that claim to be governors of the Moorish Science Temple of America don't have the Prophet's paper and condemn it, and condemn anybody who produced literature. And as a matter of fact, this brother got ran out of the temple for mentioning Northwest of Mexico. A grand sheik called himself grand sheik, called European cops on this brother for saying North America is Northwest of Mexico. That's right in your literature. A grand sheik did that. And he's still sitting in that seat.
I want to do my job.
We're not talking about anything that we say after the fact. We're talking about the responsibility of both the muftis and them assistant grand sheiks. That is the highest level of treason. And that man's still sitting in the seat. I say we have work to do.
Boy, Daddy.
Continue.
I want to give, I'm going to read an excerpt from the Moorish Guide. And this also was published in the Chicago Defender, which was a local newspaper in the city of Chicago back in the prophet days. It says, I am very anxious that those of my racial group should be better acquainted with the Constitution and thereby more clearly understand their rights. There are several states of the Union that base their suffrage upon the ability to read and interpret the Constitution. That's very important because you only have rights if you can defend them. So the circumstances that you are raising, the rights that you are arguing, the effect or the acknowledgement of those rights is based on how well you can defend them or how well you can interpret those rights. We all have divine rights or unalienable rights we speak about. They are rights that was formed with you by your creator. But you only can defend them if you can interpret them clearly. And this is important to understand. So just to repeat or mimic the term, I have rights that you have to respect, that means nothing when you're dealing with a corrupt government that overthrew the republic. So now you have to be able to interpret these rights in order to make it clear to them that they have an obligation to honor your rights. And if they don't, there are constitutional consequences behind them not doing so. And that's important. So I'm going to go further. It says, wishing to carry on a campaign of education on the Constitution, I am writing to ask your cooperation in getting this matter before the churches, schools, societies of every description with which you are associated. If you can consistently do so, will you have the people read and discuss the Constitution and the amendments thereto, section by section, until they become thoroughly acquainted with them? As loyal American citizens, we owe allegiance to the laws of our country and should know that the contents of this document in order that we may protect our rights accordingly. When one understands the Constitution, he or she will be in a position to ask his or her congressional candidate, back to that meeting, for support of every section, every amendment to the Constitution. Those candidates who are not willing to do so, again, he's addressing us and he's addressing the public at large. It says those candidates who are not willing to do so should not be elected to office. Those who are willing to do so should be earnestly supported and elected. Now once again, this article was written by Oscar De Priest, which was a member of the Moral Science Temple of North America and also held a seat with the city of Chicago. So, working in government and working in the Moral Science Temple of America, which is still a part of the government, he made sure that the representatives of the government held their obligation to make sure that they make the Constitution a part of the curriculum of the city of Chicago. From the fraternal organizations to the religious institutions to the schools, etc. And also, the members of the Moral Science Temple had an obligation to the same. So I'm bringing that to your attention so people don't think that, okay, well, Noble Drew Ali did not teach or did not endorse this type of teachings that we're talking about right now. We're just picking up where he left off. In that day, they were very active with the Constitution. So if they were active back then, there's no reason why we should not be active now, constitutionally speaking.
Islam. Not only is not that there any reason why we should not, and with all due respect, we need, the truth needs no apology. If we're aligned with the birthright and the inherited right of our people and to love our children and our people, we have a duty and responsibility to teach constitutional law. It's the heart of the movement. It's not a peripheral. It's not an afterthought. It's at the heart of the Moorish movement. He says, help me in my mission to bring my people back into the constitutional fold of government, enforcing our constitution of the United States of North America. Does that need interpretation? It does not. It's very clear. And anyone or any person alleging to be a so-called leader or grand chief or seekers in the Moorish Science Temple of America who disagrees with that statement is an enemy to the cause and should be unseated at once. There is no option for peace. Our babies' lives are at stake for these criminals. And you've been giving them dues. Why do you think you don't have no buses? Why do you think you don't have any schools? But yet they've been running them funds for 100 years. And you have never charged them fees. Why do you think the prophet did the additional bylaws in the questionnaire? Because of these embezzlers. And you have not enforced your own law. Think about it, Moors. Caveat emptor. And as the grand chief talked about the priest, so let's talk again about Obama's administration. So Rahm Emanuel is what you call a Jew. Am I correct? And he worked in the White House. He left the White House, right, in 2010. And he ran for the mayorship of Chicago. And this is connection, right? So we put out, because the Europeans, absence of the Moorish guide, and because we don't, at this time, print the Moroccans, Al Moroccan Star, because we're doing so much other work. However, the people would not know what's going on. And so the Europeans have been talking about the Moors using boilerplate, writs, etc., to try to protect themselves from these colorful operatives, de facto government, putting these people under colored law operations, stealing their property, their vessels off the street, etc., pretending to be government, and then taking their stuff and selling it under piracy law.
GPS signal lost.
So Rahm Emanuel, who's a Jew, we sent a proclamation out, Sister Anna Ida and myself, to protect and defend the Moorish movement, because they've been slandering them in both courts and in the press. So we sent an international proclamation to the nations, and these is the persons or the nations we sent them to, being we're part and parcel of this said government, and we're taking our places amongst the affairs of men in accord with the rules, customs, and the usage of the Moorish Science Temple of North America, in accord with the instructions by the prophet. And he declared that we are put in place or in power to make law. And we know law, and we deal with law. We don't deal with emotions. United Nations, International Criminal Court, International Justice Court, Great Seal National Association of Moorish Affairs, two divisions, United States Justice Department, United States Secretary of State, Moroccan American Association of North Carolina, the Embassy of Morocco, the Moroccan Consulate in New York, United States, Embassy of Bolivian Republic of Venezuela, Embassy of Cuba, People's Republic of China, Embassy, Embassy of South Africa, Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and United States Department of Homeland Security, and that's just for starters, right? Because they talk in trash. So every time you give them stuff, they try to bury it and talk trash. So we sent it to the governments. So in a few months, these proclamations start coming out from all over the country. Seal. Let me just read one. That's Rahm Emanuel, the Jew, worked for Obama. After we sent this proclamation out, then they start pouring in. And all of them are in this paper. This is from the mayor of Chicago, from the office of the mayor. City of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel. dated this 22nd day of December, 2011, and understand that the 22nd day of December is your north gate, i.e. is right in the beginning, the first day of what? The winter solstice, in accord with the circle seven. That notch that you see at the top of your circle seven, that begins there. Proclamation. Office of the Mayor, seal. City of Chicago, in harmony with the priest, as we're carrying out the law, prophet, whereas the Moorish Americans are the descendants of the ancient Moabites, Hamathites, and Canaanites, who were permitted by the old pharaohs of Kemet to traverse from East Africa and later form themselves kingdoms extending from the northwestern and southwestern shores of Africa, the Atlantic Islands, onto the present-day continental Americas, and whereas the indigenous Moorish peoples of the Americas are now united in order to again link themselves with the families of nations, and whereas the Moorish Americans, being aboriginal to the territories of North, Central, and South Americas, have formed a sovereign democratic government guided by the command principles of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, through virtue of the universal rights of self-determination, as well as the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, guaranteed in the Charter, and whereas on January 8, 1886, Noble Drew Ali was born in the state of North Carolina, destined to become the first patriarch of his mentally enslaved Moorish American people. In 1912, he later anointed Ilhaj Sharif Abdul Ali by the heads of Egypt and Holy City of Mecca to return to the United States as the last prophet and founding father of the newly risen nation of Moorish Americans. And as a result of the 13th Amendment, Moorish people were emancipated from slavery in 1865. Now, therefore, I, Rahm Emanuel, Mayor of the City of Chicago, do hereby proclaim January 8th through the 15th to be the Moorish American Week in Chicago and urge all residents to recognize the events planned at this time, dated the 22nd day of December 2011, Rahm Emanuel, Blue Ink Signature. And all these other proclamations correspond in with that. And a couple other mayors and other persons in different territories try to rescind it after the fact, but they got to recognize that they got to do what? Rescind and revamp their school books. But we had to send some outside the country to get that kind of response because they don't want to be charged with human trafficking. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And when they started talking trash and the press and everything, all in the Grand Chiefs, of course, this country should have been speaking up and still sitting back criticizing the act of Moors. So again, Grand Chief, I commend you for seeing to it that the prophet's paper is maintained. This is history on the ground. Respect it. And all you have to get it. Make sure our babies get slaves. Because if you don't get it to them conceptually now, remember as the generations pass, concepts are lost. And the mental disconnect takes place, which is called psychologically disassociation, which is really what our people suffer from. And so other people are still confirmed, these are politicians around the country, reaffirming what's in your Holy Quran. How come nobody's talking about it? Why? Because they have not been operating for the good of this movement. Every Moorish American should know about this. I'm gonna make sure they have copies. So y'all want some copies?
Yes, sir.
So don't think that they're not paying attention to you. But what you got to recognize is that we have to do our jobs. If we take on these titles, then we have to stand for the Moorish movement. Not for the party, not personalities, but for the movement. And as it is said in the chapter in the Holy Quran, when it talks about the charters, what does it say? You have a right to form your own customs, name and customs, as long as you are in accord with the grand body, which means the principles. And so when you see them grand chiefs talking about, Noble Drew Ali ain't supposed to call this great seal, great Moorish Science Temple of America, they're violating the law. And all you need to do is go to the prophet's words and defend the movement. because the principles of what you're supposed to carry out, and that great seal is the insignia of the Moorish nation, and we are government, and you're supposed to act accordingly. Now, as the prophet said, enforce the Constitution. How are you going to have people enforce the Constitution when they don't know civics, which is the science of government? It's ridiculous for the argument to even exist, and yet they've been allowed to get away with it, attacking the prophet from the seats of government within the Moorish movement itself, and have gone unchallenged, and taken finance from the people. And they're criminals, and they should be charged accordingly, but they're sacrificing your babies. So don't you punk out just because they say they're grand governors.
And also I want to point out Act 1 of the Divine Constitution of the Mosai Temple.
Here's the proclamation we sent out before that.
We're going to go from Act 1, and we're going to correspond with Article 1 of the United States of America Constitution. And we're going to see why it was a need for the prophet to even set the Constitution in the first place. When you go into Article 1, Section 8, we're still talking about the Congress. And it says the powers of Congress. Congress shall have the power to lay and collect taxes. This is your government. So now what we got to deal with is this. Who's collecting the taxes? Is the Congress collecting your taxes?
Who's an IRS?
So once again, it's very clear that there's a violation of the Constitution. Now, let's go down to establish an uniform rule of naturalization. That's very key there. Because Congress was given the power to make uniform rule for naturalization. Now, we use the term nationalization. But now, the difference is, there was a Nationalization Act in 1790 that was put by Congress of the United States, what dealt with the issues of nationality. But then, the next Nationality Act that they came out with, they changed it to the Naturalization Act. So Congress only addressed nationality one time. And that one time, they did not include the Moorish Americans as being a citizen of the United States of America. That's one key. So Congress was given the power to make a uniform rule to deal with nationalization or naturalization, whichever term that they use, because the international relations use naturalization and nationalization as being one and the same. However, the U.S. changed the definition and the interpretation of nationality and naturalization, and they chose to use the term naturalization, and they did make uniform rules of naturalization, but they bureaucratized its meaning. So now when they naturalize any citizen or make laws that deal with naturalization, it's always based on the 14th Amendment. So any person that's naturalized or confers citizenship on here in the United States is automatically classified under the 14th Amendment, which is not valid law. So because there was no legislative, organic legislative body that dealt with the issue of nationalization or naturalization, Prophet Noble Drew Ali found the need to establish it himself. And you really need to understand that. That's why in Act 1, it says the Grand Sheikh and the Chairman is empowered to make law and enforce law.
Islam.
Because what he understood was Congress failed to do the job.
Islam.
That originally was Congress' job. Where the treaty, he explained, that they held no official capacity under the Republic anymore. So there was no Congress, and still to this day, there is no official Congress coming from the seats of the Republic on that side.
And they can't.
So what the Prophet Noble Drew Ali did was set it up himself. So Congress is really embedded within the seat of the Morasan's temple. That's the way he set it up. But the same problem occurred when he said COINTELPRO came in. COINTELPRO understood what Nobuju Ali did, so they countered what he did, and they came in and controlled the seats of the Morasan's temple so that they made sure that there was still no uniform rule pertaining to naturalization or nationalization. This is why we still have the race problem in classification in the United States right now.
Yeah.
Even though we understand we Moorish American and we change the boxes on the applications in the documents, we should not have to do that.
That's correct.
That should have already been a classification long time ago. And that's what the project was trying to get us to understand, that the race game itself is a fiction. There's only one race. So to reclassify the identity of people as a race is unconstitutional. And the seats of the Morasan's temple, the leaders should have addressed that a long time ago. And we would never have to be making this conversation right now.
Now, and it's important to know the distinction between nationalization and naturalization. Number three. Yes. This is why also, as a standard rule, Nobuju Ali commanded, keep in mind, in Moorish culture, a library is as standard as a kitchen. Give me the number three. Is that number three? Law.
The law?
Yeah. Well, never mind. Give me a fourth. I got a fourth here. That's all right, good brother. And so that, because one of the things that's very important for everybody, we don't want to be talking above everyone's head because everybody's not necessarily privy to this. You need to know this to protect your family. Understand this information is for your redemption, socially, politically, and economically. And if you don't know these things, you can be and will be taken advantage of every day. Because one of the keys to them mistaxing you is by virtue of misclassifying you. And if you don't know that, guess what? They're going to steal all your cookies and your peanut butter. And so don't sit around talking about racism because they're just stealing your birthright. And it goes on every day. So stop marching and praying. Slow down and start reading. That's why Nobuju Ali said every temple, he didn't say may, he didn't say it was a good idea. You know, if you all feel like it, the prophet said every temple must have a school. We ain't got to get into that right now because we'll get ready to get angry. But anyway, let's talk about naturalization. And this is important for you to understand the distinction so that you can understand again why Moors can never be naturalized. And also why it creates a conundrum for the political system when dealing with us. See, because you being aboriginal and indigenous to the land are the heirs apparent to all estates, corporal and incorporeal. So to acknowledge you would be to end colonial powers. Are we clear? So they don't want you to remember that they're colonists, which is why they use the color system so you don't think nation principle and recognize you're under occupation. Are we clear? This is why they falsely project America as a country when it's continents, hoping you don't pay attention to the details. Are we clear? And it's dangerous not to pay attention to the details.
Remember, continent is fairly recent itself. It wasn't always a continent.
Yes, because of the great earthquake. Now, naturalization. Now keep this in mind. Raise your hand. How many are you familiar with chapter 47 of the Word called the Temple of Science? Circle 7? It's not enough hands.
Repeat that question, please.
How many of you are familiar with chapter 47 of the Moors? One. This is dangerous politically because you have to understand world politics. Because all treasury bonds of the U.S. under trusteeship of the Surety and Exchange Corporation is against your Moorish estate. Are we clear? So if you don't know these fundamental things, you would be declared incompetent. And by virtue of that, the corporate state is doing what is called legally escheating your properties and selling them or getting drafts on them. This is the basis of their wealth. Meaning that the United States Corporation doesn't have money, they don't use money, they make liens against your estate as long as you're unconscious, and they've been getting away with it. And because the so-called fake grand governors operating, infiltrating this movement have not been teaching constitutional law by design, and because their alignment with the popes of Rome, you don't know these things, and we only saw a few hands raised in the Moorish Science Temple? And we're talking world government. We're talking about what affects you every day. We gotta fix this. Naturalization. The act of adopting a foreigner and clothing him with the privileges of a native citizen. Now you understand why Moors can't be naturalized.
Islam.
Because you are the heirs to this estate. Only Europeans and others can come naturalized. Now you understand why they have to steal your nationality and brand you and put you under the 14th Amendment in order to imply a citizenship only as a corporate straw. Because you could never be citizens of the Union State Society because they're occupying your land. Do you understand that? No, Kudjo Adwo nationalized you because you're the child of the mother. True. And divine. And all others are adoptives. Are we clear? You can't be clothed with citizenship because it's your birthright. It cannot be sold nor transferred to or by another, having nothing to do with government, but is an heirship position. Thus, you must know the truth about your nationality and your birthright.
Islam.
Are we clear?
Islam.
So, nationalize and naturalize imply issues among citizens relative to right. But the naturalized person is artificially clothed and they're alien. That's the distinction. Are we clear? And all naturalized persons must carry a naturalization card, and they must take civic tests with a defined test, not only acknowledging and supporting, but showing competence of the structure of that Constitution for the United States of America as a condition of that naturalization. And after such things are registered and the Secretary takes notes and it's affirmed and reaffirmed, such persons go through a ceremony officially, publicly, supporting and affirming that Constitution. Why not you, Moorish Americans, when you, the people of the land, don't know what the Constitution is? When it's your covenant contract for others operating in your land based in this.
Now, based on what you're saying, Prophet Noble Drew Ali made the statement that being born here
doesn't make you a citizen.
Islam.
He said one must proclaim his free national name and religion to be a citizen of this government. That's very key to understand, because even though we are aboriginal indigenous to the land, what he's saying is we did not or have not been holding a constitutional obligation to this land. So we've been outside of the constitutional construction of this government. Therefore, we wasn't holding the name in carrying out the principles of a citizen, the character of citizenship here in this particular land. Even though the present name of the land is the United States of America, it is only an adopted name based on ancient principles and a retranslation of the language of the Almorac character and language from the Moors when they already was in Morocco over across the east, which was in the what we call the Kingdom of Morocco, which is still a modern day construction. Thank you, bro. When the jurisdiction and the dominion extended across the Atlantis into the present North, South, and Central America, that's here. That gives us jurisdiction here in this particular land. Regardless if they said they brought us from the northwestern shores of Africa or not, the Prophet explained that the jurisdiction and the dominion of the Moroccan Empire extended over here. So it, even if we bought the idea that they brought us over here from the northwestern shores of Africa, the jurisdiction and dominion still lies within us. So the authority in this land still lies within the Moroccan descendants born here in America, which is us. So we are the only heirs of the land and true allodial possessors of the wealth here in this land. And if anybody is going to naturalize any citizen here, it should be us,
and
not foreigners. We never naturalize the foreigners that are here. So how are those foreigners going to come and naturalize somebody else? And then not honor our citizenship here?
And now you're paying the price for it. Ignorance of the law is no excuse, because the law has been laid down. So if you're broke, one foot on the curb, in your own land, paying taxes to Romans, thinking you got a treasury department that really is the Jesuits, and you didn't know that, who should be charged with that? From that grand government right on down. Anybody who hasn't been teaching these people civics and enforcing this constitutional law. In any other country, they'd be hung. I'm telling you the truth. In any other country, they would be hung. However, right now, they're getting away with this. But I suggest to you that if you love yourselves, if you love your babies, if you love the Prophet and the movement, you better get real, because while we're playing around, Rome is liquidating, which means while we're looking at this passively or by mere opinion, you're getting ready to be meeting some strange hard times of not eating. This has nothing to do with the fact that you ain't going to have jobs, and you're not going to have the convenience of walking to a temple and getting this information. So you better get this information while you can, get it in your heart and your mind, get it in your babies, and start studying for real, for real, for real, and understanding the nature of this movement and enforcing law. Because if you don't enforce the law, you're going to regret it. And I think we're all regretting it now. This is why you see Europeans now, left and right, nationalizing so that the IRS don't take everything that penny they got. Just like this guy, what's his name, Jim Rogers? Yeah, Jim Rogers this morning, they talk about and what Zuckerberg from Facebook is nationalizing left and right, because they know this thing is coming down, getting ready to crash sideways. Y'all better get wake. Let's go to wardship. Now these peoples called Negroes, black, and color, this says wards of the state, they're under wardship status and should be notified accordingly. Wardship, in military tenures, it is the right of the Lord to have custody as guardian of the body and the lands of the infant heir, without any account for profits. And that's what's been going on. Until he was 21 or she 16, and so the deal of it is they created the word minority, so it didn't matter what age you are that you would be incapable or incompetent to receive an inheritance, and the state, by virtue of that act under the 14th Amendment, have been escheating all of your inheritances while you sit around following idol god worship that the European gave you through these fakers pretending to have houses of gods. While in secret they're getting paid off by these Romans to keep these wars going on, and you have not challenged them. Because we've become passive. This is why Noble Drawley says, if you're not going to carry out the law, if you're not going to be true to the cause, and if you don't believe that the program is right, take off the church of affairs, get back your card and button, go back to the state where the proper family. Because guess what? They're going to liquidate everything you got. And if you think that they're not acting because you've been passive, well, they're operating on that Treaty of Verona, and just because you don't know about it, it ain't stopping while we sit around debating opinions. You better deal with some knowledge, and you better deal with some knowledge real quick. Because as you're speaking, nations are nationalizing all throughout South America, and don't think that it's not going to reverberate through the banks and it's going to hit you. They're just trying to cover this thing up to keep you passive so that they don't have chaos in the street. But middle-class European ain't going to play nigger like you do. Because they kill everything in the house, including the parakeet, because it was there. But all we do is march and pray. Well, that stuff ain't going to work. So you better get this stuff together real quick. Let's go into status. And this is very important to understand why you declare your nationality and your birthright. Because you're going to have to start claiming your estate publicly. Status is the standing, the state, or the condition. It is the legal relationship and legal relation of the individual to the rest of the community. It relates to the rights, the duties, the capacities, and the incapacities which determine a person to a given class. It is a legal personal relationship, not temporary in its nature, nor terminable at the mere will of the parties with which third persons and the state are concerned. And it is not a mere relation, while the term relation, it is not a mere relation. It also means estate, because it signifies the condition or circumstances in which one stands in regard to his property. So if you don't know these rules of society, what position does that put our people in when they're out there dealing? And they sit around talking about colors, and this is what's really going on, because they're not educated. And the Moore Science Temple was set up just for you to get this information. And you have not carried out the law because you let these fake persons claim to be leaders in the Moorish movement get away with telling the people that Drawley didn't teach civics. When the record and the microfilm clearly says that he established this as a civic organization. The religious affidavit existed for 1 year in his lifespan. All the rest of the work from 1913 up to 1928 was civic in nature and in character. And you let some phony person calling themselves some grand governor telling you that the Moorish Science Temple is not a civic organization and have neglected this movement while they're taking payoffs from this European. And here we are suffering today, and in the Moorish Science Temple of America, I ask you about constitutional principles, and two people raise their hand. But that's the heart of the movement. I suggest that you take it in consideration, not because we speak it, but for yourselves and for the welfare of your families and your babies, to rethink your positions, whatever they may have been, because it's not indicated in the intelligence level. But the world is not going to play with us. Your food if you don't know these rules. Your charge in this movement to take your places amongst the affairs of men. Failure to do so is an abandonment of your estate. And the Europeans will escheat everything that you got. You understand? In Philadelphia territory. We just came from that area. China is buying blocks of houses on the down low with people in them. And people even got mortgages paid up, think that they own it. They don't know they're listed under the 14th Amendment as sharecroppers, as tenants. And they think they're owners. And they're establishing banks across this country because they're trying to figure out how to pay the debt back of the finance that China gave Bush to try to save GM and Chrysler, etc. And the people thought they got it from the Treasury Department. The U.S. don't have a Treasury. They're a private security holding company that leans against the Moorish estate and been selling them you. Your marriage certificates have been filed in the Department of Orphans and delivered to the Commerce Department and sold as mortgages. And you think it's some agreement between you and God and Jesus and all that kind of stuff. And it's a sales. And we don't even know how things work. And we sit around talking about how we know God, Jesus, Allah, and Muhammad. We're full of crap. And people need to tell us to our face. And we need to grow up and stop being boys and girls and love our children and love our families and love principles and love right for the sake of right, not because there's some reward getting ready to come. I suggest to you all that you all start carrying out the prophet's law for your own good. I'm not trying to convince you, I'm just trying to save you some pain. Because while we're sitting around debating this government, I don't want to talk about them phony conventions they've been having. Because they ain't making no reports to the nation, and they're not dealing with anything concerning enforcing the prophet's law or improving these temples. There's not a temple in North America that should not be owned, clear title, or loyal by Moorish Americans. Less more a lot of other empty buildings around here. And Europeans have been taking over stuff because you don't know anything about estate law. And these banks don't own any of these properties. They own the forfeit position to the deeds of trust that they put against your estate when you sign that promissory note. They're selling you. Then they escheat and get you to abandon it and then go and get the escrow account and then turn around and buy the house back with what they weren't putting on the principal in the first place because they were acting as your trustee or forfeit and you don't even know contract law. Because them fake grand sheets ain't been teaching me, which is their charge to have done. And Moorish Americans are being thrown out the streets on these fake mortgages on banks that don't even own the property. They own your estate and you don't even know it's your estate. Because this stuff has not been emphasized to you, except for a handful around the country, and then the people look at them like they're out to lunch because they're claiming their estate. You understand the trouble that you're in? You're going to know it in a short while because you're going to, when I say you're all, we're talking about us collectively. You're going to feel it because they got to liquidate. They've got to liquidate. And so it's like this. We're only giving you some keys because the information is there. You don't carry it out. I don't suggest, I'm telling you bluntly, that you will be more than sorry. You're going to be hungry, biting your own flesh, and a whole bunch of other stuff. Don't talk about air conditioning. I'm serious, because you have no idea how much trouble they're in, and it's going to reflect on you. It's just not hitting you now, because right now you're sticking these plastic cards in the machine, and it ain't burping right now. In short order, they're going to burp. And if the card happens to come out, it's useless anyway. So you're going to have to learn the state law. Excuse me, let me say this one more thing. The brother, your question?
When they talk about your domicile versus your address, and your name versus your jurisdiction.
All right.
And also, let's
do one at a time so people keep up with it. First of all, where do you live?
In the body.
You live in your body, and it's the only place you can live. And when you stop living in your body, don't worry about doing business. Number two, you don't live, the address is not yours. The address is private property belonging to the post office, does not belong to you. When you say possessive, now you've created a foreign jurisdiction by which they're claiming a rule over your life. When they ask your name, they ask you what's your corporation. Your nomen or your attribute or your free national name as distinguished from the name which is the straw which they will write in all capital letters, which is the 14th Amendment person by which they claim jurisdiction. But of course, this is why Noble Raleigh tells you and tells us all to know what nationality is. And so when you fall for these questions, understand when they're asking these questions, they're setting you up to claim what is known one of the trinity of jurisdiction. The trinity of jurisdiction is personal jurisdiction, physical body, subject matter jurisdiction, classification of law, territorial jurisdiction, the capacity or the incapacity or the principle upon which the so-called person or judge is claiming a jurisdiction on the land, terra, land, at all, and whether or not the authority exists, all of which would be based in law. And so therefore, if you're a national, you have a responsibility of declaring your nationality and asking them what theirs is, and whether they have a quo warranto or delegation of authority order and put it into the records. They ask you to put your stuff into the records, aren't they? So these are fundamental rules of civilization that's taught to every civilized person, except such persons called Negroes, Blacks, and Colored, who are property instead of human beings, which is why the information has been absent from our people. Which is why when you ask these questions, which are actually elementary, third grade stuff in any other civilized country, our people looking like it's some kind of PhD stuff. Which means it's not their fault, it's the leadership's fault, because these keys have been delivered to these people 100 years ago. Why are we even debating any of these things? Except that them thieves have not been charged and removed from office last year. Deal is, these Romans have been stealing your birthright, abusing you because you have not enforced the law. But you can't enforce the law if you don't know the law. Am I correct? Morris Science Temple was put in place in order to deliver these things to you, which is why it exists. And if any such organization does not carry out the law, they're enemies to the cause and should be charged accordingly. And your dad won't sure shouldn't give you your peanut butter sandwiches or 2 cents to steal from you with. Hold them to the law, just like you do to Europeans. You understand? You're not colored people. And we're out now, look at this. This is important for some of you who don't know. Let's go look. When Noble Raleigh say we're not Negro, Blacks, or colored people, right? And you already know they promote those COINTELOperatives run around and promote this idea that we're people of color, like it's some kind of divine Afrocentricity, right? So let's go to the law and look what it means. And this would be well, make sure that you sisters, when these babies are coming up, so that you can teach them properly, so they don't get screwed by being misclassified in schools, etc., and then they pump viruses in them for later death, etc. So let's look at color. This is law. Henry Campbell Black's Law Dictionary of Ancient and Modern Jurisprudence, which is science that treats of positive law. Color, by common usage in America, this term, not identity, term, in such phrases as quote unquote colored persons, quote unquote the colored race, quote unquote colored men, and the like, is used to designate Negroes or persons of the African race, including all persons of mixed blood descended from Negro ancestry, etc., then it gives law case. But where the state constitution provided for separate schools for the white and colored races, the term white race was held to be limited to the Caucasian race, and the term colored race to embrace all other races, and then it gives law case. It has been held also that there is no legal, technical signification to the phrase colored person, which the courts are bound judicially to know. That's law. So you go in there and I'm a light-skinned, orange-skinned black guy. And we're the light-skinned black organization of rights. And no civilized person in the world has any obligation to even recognize him.
Oh, they're racist.
That's a lack of study. Yet no Drawley told you not colored, but he told you study law, didn't he?
No.
As you can see, our people's concept of what they think it is and what it actually is not jiving, is it? Is it, brother? You better know yourself. So now let's look. At free white person. Henry Campbell law, Henry Campbell black law of ancient and modern jurisprudence. And keep this in mind, this is relative to those classification terms that they use, correct? Free white persons. Free white persons referred in the Naturalization Act, which we read earlier in principle, as amended by Act July the 14th, 1870, as meaning naturally given to it when first used in one statute 103, C3, meaning all persons belong to the European races then commonly counted as white and their descendants, including such descendants in other countries to which they have immigrated. And that's what's assumed. Now we're going into the technical fact of science and government and grammar, etc. Free white persons includes all European Jews more or less intermixed, meaning that they're not mixed, they're not free white persons. Free white persons includes the peoples of Celtic, Scandinavian, Teutonic, Iberian, Latin, Greek, and Slavic descent. Free white persons includes Magyars, Lops, and Finns, and the Bosks and Albanians. Free white persons includes all mixed Latins, Celtic, Iberian, and Moorish, inhabitants of Spain and Portugal. Free white persons includes the mixed Greek, Latin, Phoenician, and North African inhabitants of Sicily, and the mixed Slav and Tartar inhabitants of South Russia. Free white persons does not mean Caucasian race. Are you clear?
Yeah.
Free white person does not mean Caucasian race, it does not mean Aryan race, and it does not mean Indo-European races, nor the mixed Indo-European, Dravidian, Semitic, and Mongolian peoples who inhabit Persia. A Syrian of Asiatic birth and descent will not be entitled to become a naturalized citizen of the United States as being a free white person, and then it gives you multiple law cases so you can see it's a status. Has nothing to do with complexion. And Europeans aren't free white persons. You are. They've traded places with you. Do you understand? This is why you have Asiatics that come from around the world and on their passport they have white man. And our people here don't know better because COINTELPRO operatives told them that white and black were identities for Africa and Europe when they're actually caste systems. Here it is right there in law. Do you understand? So it's dangerous for you to use those codes, and then they enforce the Negro codes on you, the black codes on you, then you accuse them of racism, which is the species of the human family, which makes you incompetent. Do you understand the difficulty we had that we have to re-educate our people? Now you understand what Malcolm found out and why they murdered him? Why? Because all the leadership knew this information too. After all, they came from the attic chambers of the Moorish Science Temple of America. That's why they try to act like the Moorish movement was not united at one time. And the great sellout is when the split came up and all these Negro organizations took place between 1930 and 34. That's why nobody wanted to talk about the sellout. Do you understand? Now you understand when they talk about that minister went and told Malcolm in jail how to read the dictionary, what he was really showing them? That's why when the brothers murder them, say, get your hand out of our pocket, because they're getting paid off. You understand? It's dirty. This is also why later on, Wallace left too, and so did Clarence. This is why Khalid, just before they murdered him, told the world he's Moor. But they found out. Well, guess what? Europe, pale-skinned, blue-eyed European Frenchman told Malcolm, you ain't left home. You ain't visiting home because you made the odds you left home. That's called the Great Masonic Secret, the North Gate. Right here, as in chapter 47. And everybody's been playing you, including your own. So you all better get with this, because this Roman is liquidating your state as fast as he can. Do you understand? Remember, you're not operating with money. Again, and this is why it's important for the reports to be made to the people so that they understand the position of the politicians who've been running this country. And they admit, as in on the congressional floor, that you have not been paid, and most of you have never been paid any money in your entire life. And they're taxing you, you're sharecropping your labor even, misclassified as an artificial person, and thinking color means some Afrocentric identity, and they've listed you as Christian property under the 14th Amendment in the state of Delaware, and moved exactly like real estate. That's why those questions are asked, because they are creating what you call jurisdiction before they move on.
Yes. And this is another reason why when Morris try to make proclamations pertaining to affidavits and you try to follow them in the county clerk's office, they want to block you from following documents. The county clerk is a constitutional elected office under the constitution of the state. And that's an old records department for the citizen, i.e. the sovereigns, to file their affairs there. And what happened was, if you go try to file documents now, they tell you that they're not obligated to file them because they are only obligated to file issues pertaining to real property. And this is back to what Brother Todd was saying. They're not even viewing your status going on the record pertaining to the real property or the real estate. That's why they call it real estate. Because they're claiming the real estate. And they're not going to allow you to make any claims to land according to the state's constitution. Because the clerks have came up under the state of New Jersey, which is a prepositional phrase for the corporate activity of the state corporation. No longer the state government under the state republic. So the state of prepositional phrase, like the state of New Jersey, state of New York, anytime you hear that term, that indicates the corporate activity, the bureaucratized government, disguising themselves as government in the state jurisdiction. But that's not the state republic under the Constitution. If you go into the Divine Warning for the Nation, Prophet Nobuja Ali makes reference to casting a ballot at the polls under the state constitution.
Yes.
And not under a granted privilege, which has been the pre-existing condition for many generations. What he's making reference to is all your activities you do as a citizen, being part and parcel of this government, is first acknowledged through your part and parcelship of the state government under the state constitution. The state government, collectively, which they refer to as the Union of States, makes up the United States of America body politic. But the United States of America body politic only consists of the states collectively. So your citizenship is really acknowledged through your state participation or your allegiance first under the state's constitution. The centralized constitutional national constitution you make reference to is really just the umbrella to put the checks and balances of each state in the union conducting their affairs, trade and commerce with each other. They're only for checks and balances to make sure that each state deals with equality when they're dealing with other states. But your citizenship really lies within your state constitution first, which also goes down to your organic government, which is your county, which predates the state altogether. The county was the law before the state. The state of New Jersey was only incorporated in 1947. The law has been put in place way before 1947. But your constitutional elected officer have came up under the jurisdiction of the state of New Jersey, which is a corporation, and they no longer acknowledge their obligation to the state constitution. That's why they only go according to state statutes, not constitutional law. So you must understand that to get back into the law, into the constitutional law, you have to become part of Parcell and have a fundamental understanding of your state constitution. So everybody, according to what state jurisdiction you're in, you should carry that state constitution with you at all times, because that's the law. That's the law here. If they don't acknowledge that, that's the only time you pull out the national constitution. But you're supposed to pull out the state constitution.
Which you cannot contradict. Now, incorporation papers for the United States. United States Corporation Company, and guess what year is on it? Remember Noel Raleigh? Registered Civic Organization, 1925. Counter Activity, 1925. How come the Grand Sheets ain't showing this to y'all? Who do you think they're working for? I think, in order to back up what Grand Sheet Nature is saying, I think I should read this. Y'all want to hear this?
Yes.
This is Florida Congress. Get this clear. Those of you have notes, turn on your phones so that you can hear this and go home and study so that you can protect yourself when they come at you, whether the IRS or the other clubs. And if you want any help, go to your government officials. That's what the Morris Science Temple for, because these are regencies. Are we clear? Hold them to their charge. And anybody talking about nationhood and don't teach you these things ain't nation. They're fraud. Now you want to get the report of government from nation government representatives. That's what our title represents. This is our obligation to you. We're not doing you any favor. We're carrying out our duties. Are we correct? So let me read it from page to page. It's only 4 pages. I'm going to make sure that this is left here so y'all get a copy of this from the records, from the Congress, including the Treaty of Verona. We also have this in the Protocols of Liberty book in context so you can understand. However, this is it. Are we clear? You're supposed to know this stuff. But it'll be obvious to you why these so-called leader guys is hiding this information from you too, because you should figure out that they were selling you out without telling you that anyway. From the beginning, House of Representatives, Florida Congress, with the Speaker pro tempore, the President pro tempore, all your congressmen, all your senators, all your congresswomen, all your senator women, except your all of the club's members talking about their representatives for the United States of North America when they know that they're not. They're actually working for the folks of Rome under the Treaty of Verona. So let's use their own words and examine what they say, understand why you're in trouble, etc. Also within this is your arguments against the IRS or any other frauds that's been coming, stealing your lunch money and your peanut butter sandwiches.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, we are here now in Chapter 11. Members of Congress are official trustees presiding over the greatest reorganization of any bankrupt entity in world history, the U.S. government. We are setting forth, hopefully, a blueprint for our future, and there are some who say it is a coroner's report that will lead to our demise. It is an established fact that the United States federal government has been dissolved by the Emergency Banking Act of March the 9th, 1933, 48 Statute 1, Public Law 89-719, declared by President Roosevelt being bankrupt and insolvent, H.J.R. 192, 73rd Congress, in session June the 5th, 1933, joint resolution to suspend the gold standard and abrogate the gold clause, dissolve the sovereign authority of the United States and the official capacity of all United States governmental offices, officers, and departments, and is further evidence that the United States federal government exists today in name only. The receivers of the United States bankruptcy are the international bankers via the United Nations, the World Bank, and the International Monetary Fund. All United States offices, officials, and departments are now operating within a de facto status, which means fraud, in name only, under emergency war powers with the constitutional Republican form of government now dissolved. That's why you hear them keep saying states of instead of New Jersey State Republic, which is the legitimate government. But they know they've miseducated the people, and they already know these phony fake nation leader guys ain't gonna teach you, even though they know this information, helping them trick you so they can rob you by virtue of misclassification of both you and the government. Boy, this stuff is hot. You got that right, and then some more. So the new form of government is known as democracy, being an established socialist communist order under which, under a new form of government, or governor for America. And this act, what they did, was instituted and established by transferring and or placing the office of the Secretary of the Treasury to that of the governor of the International Monetary Fund, which will be referred to as the IMF.
It's also in violation of Article 4, Section 4.
Absolutely. Now, that's public law, not constitutional law, public law, 94-564, page 8, section H.R. 13955, reads in part, the United States Secretary of Treasury received no compensation for representing the United States, which we mentioned earlier. The reason they don't get compensated is because the office doesn't exist. Gold and silver were such a powerful money during the founding of the United States of America that the founding fathers declared that only gold or silver coins can be money in America. Go read Article 1, Section 10 of the Constitution and enforce it as Governor Drawley told you to do. Since gold and silver coins were heavy and convenient for a lot of transactions, they were stored in banks, and a claim check was issued as a money substitute. So those greenbacks are the checks, not some other paper for you to get the greenbacks. The greenbacks are checks. People traded their coupons as money. Currency, quote unquote. Currency is not money. Are we clear, you all? This is coming from the floor of the Congress. Currency is not money, but a money substitute. That's a nice way of saying counterfeit. People traded their coupons as money, currency, and currency is not money, but a money substitute. Redeemable currency must promise to pay a dollar equivalent in gold or silver money. Federal Reserve notes, FRNs, make no such promises and are not money. A Federal Reserve note is a debt obligation of the federal United States government and is not money. The federal United States government and the U.S. Congress were not and never have been authorized by the Constitution for the United States of America to issue currency of any kind, but only lawful money, gold and silver coin. It is essential that we comprehend the distinction between real money and paper money substitute or counterfeit. And one cannot get rich by accumulating money substitutes. One can only get deeper in debt. We the people no longer have any money, and most Americans have never been paid any money for a very long time, perhaps not in their entire lives. Now do you comprehend why you feel broke? Now do you understand why you are bankrupt along with the rest of the country? Remember, this is the congressman. This is on the floor. The senators of Congress, all these people y'all been voting for.
These are the people, according to the Constitution, that have the vested powers to make law for the country.
And have the obligation to protect you from this very stuff. And yet they have conspired with foreigners to enforce this thing and to enforce slavery without your permission and not telling you what they've done. Federal Reserve notes, FRN, are unsigned. Listen to this carefully. Federal Reserve notes are unsigned checks written on a closed account.
I need help.
You have that? Y'all understood what I just told you? Federal Reserve notes are unsigned checks written on a closed account. Federal Reserve notes are an inflatable paper system designed to create debt. through inflation, quote unquote, devaluation of currency. And whenever there's an increase of the supply of a money substitute in the economy without a corresponding increase in the gold and silver backing, inflation occurs. Inflation is an invisible form of taxation that irresponsible governments inflict on their citizens. The Federal Reserve Bank, who controls the supply and movement of Federal Reserve notes, has everybody fooled. And they have access to an unlimited supply of FRNs, paying only for the printing cost of what they need. The Federal Reserve notes are nothing more than a promissory note for the U.S. Treasury security T-bills, a promise to pay the debt of the Federal Reserve Bank. Not the country, the bank, private, foreign. There is a fundamental difference between paying and discharging a debt. To pay a debt, you must pay with value or substance, i.e. gold or silver, barter, or commodity. With Federal Reserve notes, you can only discharge a debt, and you cannot pay a debt with a debt currency system. You cannot service a debt with a currency that has no backing in value or substance, and no contract in common law is valid unless it involves an exchange of good and valuable consideration, quote unquote. Unpayable debt transfers power and control to the sovereign power structure that has no interest in money, law, or equity, or justice, because they have so much wealth already by virtue of this fraud that they created. Are we clear? Their lust is for power and control. And since the inception of central banking, they have controlled the fates of nations. The Federal Reserve System is based, pay attention to this, because they're admitting it right here. The Federal Reserve System is based on the canon law. You know what that means?
Rome.
Canon law is the Pope's. And the principles of sovereignty protected in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. In fact, the international bankers used a canon law trust, quote unquote, as their model, adding stock and naming it a joint stock trust, quote unquote. The U.S. Congress had passed a law making it illegal for any legal person, quote unquote, to duplicate a joint stock trust, quote unquote, in 1873. And the Federal Reserve Act was legislated post facto in 1870 to 1870. Although post facto laws are strictly forbidden by the Constitution, Article 1, Section 9.3, the Federal Reserve System is a sovereign power structure separate and distinct from the federal United States government. Are we clear? The Federal Reserve is a maritime lender and or maritime insurance underwriter to the federal United States, operating exclusively under Admiralty maritime law. And the lender or underwriter bears the risk and the maritime law compelling specific performance in paying the interest or premiums are the same. Assets of the debtor can also be hypothecated to pledge something as a surety without taking possession of it, as a surety by the lender or underwriter. And the Federal Reserve Act stipulated that the interest on the debt was to be paid in gold. Get the point, how they robbed you under fraud? There is no stipulation in the Federal Reserve, Reserve Act for ever paying the principal. And prior to 1913, keep this in mind, Noble Ali established the old Canaanite temple, 1913, right? Keep in mind the political timelines. Prior to 1913, most Americans owned clear, quote unquote, allodial title. Are you all familiar with that? You better get familiar with it.
Yeah.
Prior to 1913, most Americans owned clear, allodial title to property, free and clear of any liens or mortgages, until the Federal Reserve Act of 1913. Now you recognize the counteractivity to everything Noble Drawley did. Why isn't this being reported to you? hypothecated all property within the federal United States to the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve. That's who is operating the taxing power, in which the trustees, stockholders, held legal title. The U.S. citizen, tenant, quote-unquote, franchisee. Tenant means renter, right? Franchisee, which means a corporate grant. You ain't owning nothing. How come they're not teaching you these things? So, the trustee stockholders held legal title, the U.S. citizen's tenant franchisee was registered as a beneficiary of the trust via his or her birth certificate. In 1933, the United States hypothecated all of the present and future properties, assets, and the labor of their quote-unquote subjects, the 14th Amendment citizen, to the Federal Reserve System. Now let's take this and go right to Nobuhiro Ali's command in the divine warning that the 14th and 15th Amendments not necessary for the salvation of my people and citizens. Pay attention to the correlations. In return, the Federal Reserve System agreed to extend the Federal United States Corporation all the credit money substitute, quote unquote, it needed. Like any other debtor, the Federal United States government had to assign collateral and security to their creditors as a condition of the loan. And since the Federal United States didn't have any assets, now you understand, because they're foreigners. Are we clear? They have no assets. Why? Because all the assets is the Moorish estate. Now you understand why none of them speak under that great seal on that note?
And let me correlate that so we can register that in our mind. Divine warning states that the gold, the silver, the commerce belongs to the citizens.
Citizens
the
alone.
Citizens alone.
Are we clear?
Please make that clear. And this is Congress, once again, backing up what Nobuhiro Ali was saying. They're saying the same thing.
But what is it? Why isn't this information dispensed to you by your so-called Negro leader guys and all your nation guys talking about nations and these grand sheets, which makes you victim because you don't even know it's being used against you? On top of the fact you think you own the property and they've hypothecated it. Anyway, in return, the Federal Reserve System agreed to extend to the Federal United States Corporation, keep this in mind, corporation, not the land, not the real people, private corporation, all the credit and money substituted needed. Like any other debtor, the Federal United States government had to assign collateral security to their creditors as a condition of the loan. And since the Federal United States didn't have any assets, they assigned the private property of their economic slaves, quote unquote. Now you understand all the capital letters they keep sending you in your bills? And our people don't read because they don't know the difference between a corporate person and a natural person? United States citizens as collateral against the unpayable federal debt. Unpayable. They also pledged the unincorporated federal territories, national parks, the forests, birth certificates, and nonprofit organizations as collateral against the federal debt. And all has already been transferred as payment to the international bankers. Already been done. And unwittingly, America has returned to its pre-American Revolution feudal roots, whereby all land is held by a sovereign and the common people had no rights to hold a lodeal title to property. And once again, we the people are the tenants and sharecroppers renting our own property from a sovereign in the guise of the Federal Reserve Bank. And we the people have exchanged one master for another. And this has been going on for over 80 years without the informed knowledge of the American people, without a voice protecting or protesting loud enough. Now it is easy to grasp why America is fundamentally bankrupt. Why don't more people own their properties outright, which is the question? Why are 90% of Americans mortgaged to the hilt and have little or no assets after all debts and liabilities have been paid? And why does it feel like you are working harder and harder and getting less and less? Pardon me. And we are reaping what we have sown, and the result of our harvest is a painful bankruptcy and a foreclosure on American properties, precious liberties, and a way of life. And few of our elected representatives in Washington, D.C. have dared to tell the truth. The federal United States is bankrupt. And our children will inherit this unpayable debt and the tyranny to enforce it and to enforce paying it. America has become completely bankrupt in world leadership, become completely bankrupt in financial credit, and its reputation for courage, vision, and human rights, etc. And this is an undeclared economic war, bankruptcy, and economic slavery of the most corrupt order. Wake up, America, and take back your country. And the colorable actions, color people, color laws, see the point? The culpable actions and activities revealed and exposed by the representative James Traficant in his speech before the House of Representatives gives proof to the treasonous acts of sitting politicians and party affiliations are irrelevant. The common thread that is weaved throughout both the monopolized political parties, the Republican and the Democrat, leave no doubt as to their predetermined, pre-existing, and integrity compromised agenda. And examples of international and treaty law acknowledgments, resolutions, and proclamations. These are some statements we wrote as we put the proclamations so that the people can have it in context and understand its relationship and why they're trying to look now like they're not maintaining, if you understand, human traffic, because we're proclaiming publicly our nationality and we sent it out to the other governments of the world, which all these grand chiefs were supposed to have done. So they're admitting to you on the floor of the Congress that you're economic slaves. Why is these reports not made to you? When these people are sitting around here talking about nationhood and you don't even know national and international law are totally declared incompetent and there is cheating all your property. And your marriage certificate and your birth certificates are sold as stock on the stock market and you think they're talking about some houses. And it's the houses of your zodiac law that you don't know about. Yourself, and you ain't been taught by these fake grand chiefs that criticize us for telling the truth because they don't have the courage or either they just sold out to these Romans. And this is the floor of the Congress themselves backing up everything we've been telling you. And how come you haven't been informed by these fake grand governors? Because you don't know law and you have not enforced the prophet's law, and now we're all suffering for it. And these babies are always sold out. Even the ones that ain't even born in your womb is already sold out. They've been hypothecated. And this is your report. I'll make sure y'all got this. You better get your house in order, because they're not playing with you. Are we clear?
Islam.
There's a degree of Verona that goes with it. And so, in order for you to comprehend why you nationalize, because that's your only way out. Because without your nationality and without you declaring your free national name in principle, in spirit, in knowledge, you not only have no true wealth, you will be liquidated yourself because they're going to reduce the population and they're going to use vaporization techniques in case you didn't know it. Now, so let's go to executive order. This is back to the highest level of government of the United States, executive order, order 11490, top secret, King Alpha Plan, Rex 84 Plan, concentration camps, ETC, ETC, ETC. These are the infiltrated organizations, which they have COINTELPRO members, infiltrated organizations under assailant of observation, etc. And Executive Order 11490, October 1969, Executive Order was authorized to counteract the minority blacks, Latinos, Indians, Puerto Ricans, poor whites, and their rise up from under the depression and powers that be the government King Alfred Plan. in the event of widespread and continued coordinated racial disturbances in the United States, King Albert, at the discretion of the President, will be put into effect and action immediately. Infiltrated organizations under surveillance: 1, the Black Muslims; 2, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC; 3, Congress on Racial Equality; 4, Uhuru Movement; 5, Group on Advanced Leadership, GOLD; 6, Freedom Now Party; 7, United Black Nationals of America; 8, New Pan-African Movement; 9, they don't have 9 listed here, but they go up to 10, National Urban League; the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People; Committee on Racial and Religious Korak; Progress, etc. Note, at the appropriate time to be designated by the President, the leaders of some of these organizations are to be detained only when it is clear that they cannot prevent the emergency, and working with local police or public officials during the first 24 hours, all other leaders are to be detained at once. Compiled list of minority leaders have been readied at the National Computer Data Center, and it is necessary to use the minority members who are agents for central and federal. And we cannot, until there is no alternative, reveal King Albert in all its aspects. Minority members of Congress will be unseated at once. And this move is not without precedent in American history. Attorney General of the United States, preliminary memo, Department of Defense. This memo, pay close attention to this paragraph, you all, and particularly those who don't have a background in Moorish history and culture and Moorish science, because it's very revealing and it's important for you to know, and this is also one of the things that Malcolm found out why they murdered him. Preliminary memo, Department of Defense. This memo is being submitted in lieu of a full report from the Joint Chiefs of Staff. That report is now in preparation. There will be many cities where the minority will be able to put into the street a superior number of people with a desperate and dangerous will. He will be a formidable enemy, for he is bound to the continent by heritage. Y'all get that? This is government secret document. They're admitting that you're bound to this continent by heritage. It is a country, continent. That backs up chapter 47. How come these black leader guys keep on telling these people that you came from someplace else, when everybody knows that you're aboriginal and indigenous to this land? See the great Masonic secret? Now you understand why none of the politicians speak under that great seal pyramid on the back of that note? Because it's yours. See why them grand, fake grand chiefs be telling people that I ain't never done in that thing, Sam. This is who they're working for. That's why you ain't been given this information. Because it exposes them, doesn't it? Now you know why they shut down the prophet's paper. Talking about grand governor. Yeah, right. Anyway, he will be a formidable enemy, for he is bound to the continent by heritage and knows that political asylum will not be available to him in other countries, which means you ain't going to no other countries because you ain't accepted because you're home. You better take care of your business here. The greatest concentration of the minority is in the deep south, the eastern seaboard, the Great Lakes region, and the west coast. So let's talk about why Noble Dwali said every temple must have a school. So let's look at what they're doing to you absolutely consciously with your babies that you keep delivering to them in the name of whatever you want to call it. And we're going to deal with this. Remember, this is them. This is your highest level of government of the United States. strategy engineering you. And is their opinion of examining you and studying you? Energy. Energy is recognized as the key to all activity on Earth. Natural science is the study of the sources and control of natural energy. And social science, theoretically expressed as economics. It is the study of the sources and control of social energy. Both are bookkeeping systems, mathematics. Therefore, mathematics is the primary energy science, and the bookkeeper can be king if the public can be kept ignorant of the methodology of the bookkeeping. All science is merely a means to an end. And the means is knowledge. The end is control. Beyond this remains only one issue: who will be the beneficiary, quote unquote. In 1954, this was the issue of primary concern, although the so-called moral issues were raised. In view of the law of natural selection, it was agreed that a nation or world of people who will not use their intelligence are no better than animals. Who do not have intelligence. And such people are beasts of burden and stakes on the table by choice and by consent. Consequently, in the interest of future world order, peace and tranquility, it was decided to privately wage a quiet war against the American public with the ultimate objective of permanently shifting the natural and social energy, quote-unquote, wealth of the undisciplined and irresponsible many to the hands of the self-disciplined, responsible, and worthy few. In order to implement this objective, it was necessary to create, to secure, and to apply new weapons, which, as it turns out, were a class of weapons so subtle and sophisticated in their principle of operation and public appearance as to earn for themselves the name, quote unquote, silent weapons. In conclusion, the objective of economic research, as concluded by the magnates of capital banking, go right back to the floor of Congress, go back to the Treaty of Verona, and you see this whole thing is connected. That's the danger of not knowing history and law. And the industries of commodities, goods, land, services, and the establishment of an economy which is totally predictable and manipulable. In order to achieve a totally predictable economy, the low-class elements of society must be brought under total control, i.e., must be housebroken, trained, and assigned a yoke and a long-term social duty and long-term social duties from a very early age, before they have an opportunity to question the propriety of the matter. In order to achieve such conformity, the lower class family unit must be disintegrated by a process of increasing preoccupation of the parents and the establishment of government-operated daycare centers for the occupationally orphaned children. The quality of education given to the lower class must be of the poorest sort, so that the meat of ignorance isolating the inferior class from the superior class is and remains incomprehensible to the inferior class. With such an initial handicap, even bright lower class individuals have little, if any, hope of extricating themselves from under their assigned lot in life. And this form of slavery is essential to maintaining some measure of social order, peace, and tranquility for the ruling class, etc. Now I just want to read this one last page and put it in context. This is how your politicians have been approaching you, and the same thing with these agents in these Negro organizations who have been claiming to be your Negro leader guys, who are working with central and federal to promote this BS, which is why they don't take the step to expose this information to you, because it would expose them. Now you understand why them grand chiefs criticize me and Nature and others who produce literature?
Yep.
Because they are COINTELPRO operators declared right in on the floor of the U.S. Congress. and right in King Alfred plan, clear as day. But I love these babies. And if I can help it, I didn't come in this movement to play. And I ain't a club member. I'm a member of the Moorish Divine Movement of the world. And will live the life accordingly forever as long as I breathe. Descriptive introduction of the silent weapon. Everything that is expected from an ordinary weapon is expected from a silent weapon by its creators, but only in its manner of functioning. It shoots situations instead of bullets. It is propelled by data processing instead of chemical reaction, quote unquote, explosion, originating from bits of data instead of grains of gunpowder, from a computer instead of a gun, operated by a computer programmer instead of a marksman, under the orders of a banking magnet instead of a military general. It makes no obvious explosive noises, causes no obvious physical or mental injuries, and does not obviously interfere with anyone's daily social life. Yet, it makes an unmistakable noise. It causes unmistakable physical and mental damage and unmistakably interferes with daily social life, i.e. unmistakable to a trained observer, one who knows what to look for. The public cannot comprehend this weapon and therefore cannot believe that they are being attacked and subdued by a weapon. The public might instinctively feel that something is wrong, but because of the technical nature of the silent weapon, they cannot express their feelings in a rational way or handle the problems with intelligence. And therefore, they do not know how to cry out for help and do not know how to associate with others to defend themselves against it. When a silent weapon is applied gradually to the public adjusts, adopts to its presence and learns to tolerate its encroachment on their lives until the pressure, psychological via economic, quote unquote, becomes too great and they crack up. Therefore, the silent weapon is a type of biological warfare. It attacks the vitality, the options, the mobility of the individuals of society by knowing, understanding, manipulating, and attacking their sources of natural and social energy and their physical, mental, emotional strengths and weaknesses. Does that sound like prejudice to you, or does that sound like a plan?
A plan. Serious plan, too.
It's already working.
So you Negro leaders have you running around talking about light-skinned, orange-skinned, green people, and the Asiatic black man, and the light-skinned, orange-skinned, white man. And this is what's been in operation all the time. Why they ain't fix nothing. And those leaders are agents for central and federal, which is why they won't get on these subject matters and why they won't teach nationality, which is your only way out. Do you understand?
Yes.
Give me the treaty book, Treaty of Peace and Friendship. Update, Ron. And this is for those brothers and sisters who have not been taught, let's talk law. And this includes some Moorish Americans who've been misrepresenting and trying to sell you some package of birthright that cannot be sold. I'll be clear. And those who are trying to naturalize you when you're the natural inheritors or parent of this land. So let's go to the law and let's go to the United States law. Naturalization. Now, how many of you in here are more science temple of marijuana? So you all have a background, and particularly to the sisters, because it's most important for you all to know, and particularly to you, so you know the real world, what you ain't been told by your Negro leader guys, and what has not been enforced amongst you, what should have been enforced amongst you, so that you'll understand the real politics that's happening here in the world. This is original article of Amendment 13 with its 20 sections, unlike the two sections you get in your school books. And I'm going to read section number 12. The trafficking in slaves of Africa is hereby forever prohibited on pain of death and the forfeiture of all the rights and property of persons engaged therein, and the descendants of Africans shall not be citizens. So can anybody have you marching around under some civil rights telling you that you're citizens of the U.S. when you can never be by law?
Exactly.
Which means they are conscious that that is a foreign jurisdiction and a private European corporation pretending to be government, and they've been enslaving you. And they know it. Again, I repeat again, now you understand why them so-called grand governors of the Moorish Science Temple of America shut down Noble Drawley's paper. So you can't read things like the priest said with the enforcement of the Constitution. You understand which Grand Chief Major Eel published for your edification and consideration and political, social, historical analyzation in the Moorish Guide paper, which should be all over this country. In harmony with what the Prophet commanded, not what he suggested, he commanded. So now let's go directly from that and go into citizenship of the United States and look what is absolutely obvious and indisputable, but not taught again by certain persons claiming to be grand governors who keep telling you this is not a civic organization. United States citizenship. And I left the type just as it was in the records. So the phony grand sheets who criticize us all the time for the work that we're doing can't refute it. Citizenship of the United States, expatriation, ETC, page 459. That's for all scholars and phonies who want to dispute this. Morocco. Sir, there are strictly speaking no Moroccan laws relating to citizenship of the Moor subjects in Morocco. The fundamental laws of this non-Christian country are based entirely upon the Islamic code, and no part of which treats of the subject of citizenship. Page 460, Citizenship of the United States, Expatriation, ETC. There are, however, numerous treaties and conventions between the various Christian countries and the Moorish Empire. By means which citizenship in this country is defined. But as I understand from the above acknowledged instructions that it is not the desire of the department to call for a report on such lines. I will therefore confine these remarks to general conditions existing, which may possibly be of some use in connection with the information desired. Number one, listen to this, you all. This United States law on citizenship. Number one, citizenship in Morocco may be said to be governed by the laws pertaining to the same in other countries, with the exception that all persons residing in Morocco who cannot prove foreign citizenship or protection are considered, if so jure, Moorish subjects. That means with or without a nationality card. If you can't prove that you are a citizen of some other nation, you are ipso jure Moorish subject. That's United States law. How come them grand governors ain't teaching this to these Moorish Americans? Mm-hmm. Because they're making you think that you got to come under their particular club to be who you are by birthright. So they can try to control you or sell it to you in a package, which can't be sold because it's your inherited bloodline. And if anything, you got to prove that you ain't Moorish American.
Exactly.
That's United States law. See why they don't like us? Because they can't own you. That's why they make sure you don't get this information. We ain't playing with them. They ain't stealing our babies, selling through these rooms. The above, hold on. Now, look, now this is number two and three. More subjects, back to the issue of naturalization and nationalization, is law. Two and three, more subjects lost their nationality only by becoming naturalized.
Exactly. And this is a problem that you might run into, and you will run into. States and all the states collectively have adopted state statutes as their rule of law for citizenship. And within that construction, being that they abandoned the common law procedure, they will say that you need to answer to a name change by a court order decree. That court order decree is a statutory requirement. You must understand that.
And you're not committed.
You don't have to follow the statutory requirement. The statutes themselves, in the beginning of the statute, says that the statute is only an assistance to the common law. The statutes themselves, they're saying that the only purpose of their statutes is to enhance the common law that already exists. So if they tell you that they're not going by common law, then that means they can't go by statutory law. Because statutory law is supposed to be symbolic of the common law. So this becomes your argument with them or the court or whoever's forcing you into a common law name change, is that if you're saying that that's a court requirement based on statutory law, the statutory law itself said it derives its authority from the common law. So that means that whoever's telling you that is unconstitutional. Unconstitutional and could be sued for that. That's where you gotta get into active protocol. What do you do when somebody violates the Constitution? Do you get mad? Do you get emotional? Do you march? No. Do you go back into a Negro state of mind? No. What you do is the same thing they do to you when you don't follow the statutes. They sue you. Because that's the procedure. If they say you didn't follow the law, then they sue you. A traffic citation is a lawsuit. Anytime you are summoned to court is a lawsuit, point blank. So vice versa, you have the same obligation as a citizen. If they don't follow the law or they violate the law, you sue them. It's nothing personal. It's basic American, it's the American way.
Exactly.
So if you have a problem proclaiming your free national name and correcting your name, and a governmental official gave you a problem with that, then my question to you is, why haven't you sued them? You can't say that they won't do it. A lot of people call me and say that, or they won't do it, or they're not going to do it. That's not true. Before you sue an agency, you just do something very simple. It's called an intent to sue.
Give them a COL.
That's what they do to you when you don't pay a bill. They don't just go and automatically sue you, they give you an intent to sue. And that's what you do. If they don't follow the constitutional requirements, you send them an intent to sue. And within that, you show intelligent laws to show why they have an obligation to do what they're not doing. Once they see that, 9 times out of 10, they're gonna go ahead and change it because they don't want the lawsuit.
And understand this, you know, the more and more these questions are fielded, and more you listen to Grandship Nature, you can see that the nature of this movement is civics. And for someone to even imply a little bit that is other than that is both fraud and a lie. the dealers and answer the sister again. The reason why she's having difficulty is because she doesn't know basic civilization principles, which is what the Moorish movement is about. And so one of the things that we must do is we must stop allowing the misconception of this movement being misrepresented by persons who claim to be leaders that keep taking the national side of this movement and trashing it and pretending that this is not a divine and national movement. Because now we know that they're COINTELPRO operators, we don't have to argue that. What is arguable is the act of Moors allowing it to continue. Are we clear?
Yes.
What is a violation is, whereas if you have such questions that they're not answered, are we clear? If you ask questions amongst anyone who's representing any nation, state, etc., they have obligation to answer these questions. It's not optional. And if they can't answer the questions, they need to sit down. Are we clear?
Islam.
So amongst yourselves, and of course we've been doing work over the years to try to accommodate, but we're just individuals, members of the nation, doing what limited we can, even to our unqualified position. We're doing the best we can with what we have, with our limited resources. However, you must know that this job applies to anybody called Seekers and Grand Seekers. Are we clear? And if they're not carrying out these things and you allow them to sit in these seats, understand you're selling your own babies out. So you're going to have to take responsibility. And just like Noble Drawley said in the Divine Warning, and for the sister in the Land of Flowers, study the Constitution, bylaws, study the treaty of 1786, 87, and there's other treaties too, which we will be forwarding to you for your approbation, which should be presented to you in any more Science Temple of America. And if they don't do it, it's fine, because we're going to give it to you anyway. And we're going to be putting things on whatever websites that we have already constructed, and or which will be constructed in order to get this work done on the hedges and the highways. But we have to depend on you as being members of the Moorish Nation to take responsibility to aid in the uplifting of fallen humanity, to take what you know, as you all have been doing in Canaanland, which is, I also must again give you all props for it.
Islam.
Yes, Islam.
Islam.
And this is an interesting thing. I want to say this because this is very important. This is very important. For brothers and sisters here, Brother Kudjo, Canaanland, and with all due respect, for the short time comparatively that these brothers have had the information, they have done more with this information in a couple of years than I've seen some of these grand sheets that have had this stuff for 20, 30 years. What it honestly demonstrates is when people get this information, and if their heart is pure to the cause, there's no such thing as that they can't comprehend or that they don't understand. He's a perfect example of it. So don't let nobody come across to you who's had this information playing Grand Sheiky guy. Mm-hmm. And you react like, and they don't quite understand it. You know, don't even begin to accept it. And again, I have to give you props, brother. And brothers and sisters, send the greetings to Canaanland from us.
Right.
And keep up the good work. Make sure the babies get it at all costs. Make sure them sisters get it. Make sure they rub their wounds with it, so everything that comes out that wound is coming through the Stargate already resurrected. Thank you for coming to the War Science Temple of America. And from me and myself, I got grand respect. I wish we could come to Canaanland loosely and regularly. Anyway, and also I respect that brothers, they even do music because they're musicians anyway. And have been getting across You know, I had a lecture with Sister Sanford, the lawyer in the UK.
Okay, all right.
Oh, yeah, well, she's suing the Queen for reparations.
Oh,
so I did a radio show with her.
Wow.
For real.
Across the ocean. And, but brothers and sisters in the UK, you got some music, you know.
Yeah, well, all right, that's good, that's good. All right. All right.
And it's appreciated.
Good, thanks.
But the point of it is, when you produce literature, and even music is literature, it goes where you can never go.
Exactly.
And when you change the state of the people's mind, they will change the state of their condition. Are we clear?
Yes.
Wish we had more time. You understand? Support your temple. Please take your time when you come in here and go look and read some of the information. Keep in mind, this is archive here. And these is papers that many of the COINTELPRO members don't want you to see. Once you start studying some of the papers with Noble Drolley, you'll recognize that he's taking a universal view and making a space for anybody, an organized group that's working for universal justice. So when some of them fake grand sheets start talking that little clubism stuff, sister, don't you ever even fall for it. Because they are absolute frauds. And when they dismiss you, they did you a favor to take you out of their presence, because they are the ones who are not worthy.
Freedom.
The nation is out here.
Islam.
And get your work done.
All right.
Anyway, Grand Sheikh Nature, I want to commend you again, because I haven't seen you in 2 minutes. Love the babies that are growing up. Keep up the good work. And this is a demonstration of what a temple should be starting to look like, either. You understand? To give you something to reference. Because when you read the prophet's words, you'll recognize who's who and who's not. By what they do, what they claim, and whether or not they're taking this information to the people. And then not trying to choke them whilst. Because remember, this is birthright, you all. If it's birthright, it can't be sold, right?
Exactly.
It's unalienable, right?
Right.
It ain't a privilege, right?
No, it's not.
For a minute, put your hand up and feel the pulse. Get in the rhythm of the universe and understand that's your pedigree, that's your birthright, there's your nationality. It can't be put on paper because it's your bloodline. What's your nationality?
North American.
Peace.
Islam.
All Mars are active. Never passive. All Mars are active. Never passive. Before I nationalized in 2007, I used to wonder why Moors talk like a reverend. God drew Ali like a religious idol, and that I have to listen to them cause they're the station or title. Moorish pastors active, Moors actors. God drew like a pirate and they're the parrots. On the shoulder, repeating everything, never doing. Constantly trying to stagnate the movement. Drew said new Moors will come with eyes wide open. Seeing and knowing, not the kind hoping. Move up from belief to faith into fruition. Couldn't answer my question, but you want me to listen. When I mention H.L. or Taj Tarik Bey, they dissing. Saying Moors are on a suicidal mission. Moors told me I'll get locked up, don't follow Taj. The sheriffs have authority with a 6-point badge. Don't follow Nature Bey, he's not a Moor. But when I watch his classes, he's saying much more. When I mention Dawid Ali El in Mecca, if words could injure, that Moor would be on a stretcher. When I mention Elihu, they say he lied too. But they always say Circle 7 is the Moors Bible. They engage me, so I say they do. Didn't want me to be on the lessons that I drew.
People, same people would sit around and say, you know, these crackers stole everything, and these crackers don't have nothing if it wasn't for us. But then we'll sit right around and turn around and say that we are taking from them, 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 from them.
Passives get mad when I call them out, asking where's the unity when I call them out. My union is to the prophet and Allah that sent him. Not the temple, more sheik wanting my attention. Begging me to file a UCC-1 on the straw to get me under contract when I wasn't before. They don't even care about void ab initio. Still saying the African Moors, the Scipio Africanus. Prophet saves us since Pan-American Conference. And all the passive nonsense. This is not the Islam pushing bomb threat carts. True Moors, a par selling part.
We are the original Masons, okay? Not the European. Yes, they did take it in.